Hello. This is a video where we go through applications of the derivative using Excel. I've got a couple of different applications we're going to do. And with this, it's the whole idea of how does Excel make our work easier. So that will be the focus of what I'm doing here. So we're going to start with number one, where it says the instantaneous rate of change, IRC. So the function R of P is equal to that function represents the revenue of ABC Manufacturing, where P is the dollars per widget and R of P is the revenue in thousands of dollars. What we want to do is we want to set up our spreadsheet so that our spreadsheet will be useful and helpful to us. So you can see that I've inserted already three columns. Let's start with these three. P is going to be our independent variable price, D of P, or demand, and R of P. Now, I know that I've only given you one formula over here, but you already know that price times demand is equal to revenue. And because I know that instantaneous rate of change involves the first derivative, I know that this thing is going to involve the product rule for its derivative. So the reason that I've put the demand piece in there is it's going to help me when I come over here and look at the derivative. So let's get started and I'll uncover what I've done. First thing you want to do is let's go ahead and set up a reasonable price demand. I have some values that I've used that I need to answer questions with over here. So you can see a couple of the values come from the questions I'm answering. Now, for the demand formula, all I'm doing is I'm typing in the second piece of the revenue function, 500E to the negative 0.016P. I drag that down. I come to the revenue formula. And for revenue, I don't need to type in my revenue function again. I just need to type in A3 times B3. So these first three columns basically are basics. They're things that we did in our first test cycle. What I've added here is actual dollars. And if you read back in the problem's just talking about its revenue in thousands of dollars. So my formula here is simply just to say 1,000 times the value that I got in my revenue function. So, for example, the actual revenue when a price is 76 cents is $375,407.18. The actual revenue when my price per widget is $3.50 is $1,654,693.49. And I know that actual dollars there helps a little bit. And you can also see that I just used my dollar sign in this column to give my dollar amount. Okay, when I move down to the third question, find the instantaneous rate of change when the price is exactly $1, that's a little bit different. So for instantaneous rate of change, we actually need a derivative column. And what I'm going to show you here is how to do the derivative in Excel without perhaps writing too much down on your paper. So what we do to take the derivative of our function, we know that it's product rule and we want to access cells where we can. So we would basically look at this and go, all right, well, for one thing, I know that it's going to be the first times the derivative of the second. The first is simply my price. So I can click on my price times the derivative of my second. Well, the derivative of that is going to be the second, which is B3, and then times, remember, the derivative of the exponent, which would be negative 0.016. So the first times the derivative of the second plus the second times the derivative of the first. Here, sometimes people get a little bit concerned. What I want you to think about for the derivative of the first is from the function. What is the derivative of P? The derivative of P is 1. That's where you see this 1 coming back. So you could access cells for everything except the derivative of the exponent here and the derivative of p, which was 1. You may want to pause the video, look at that, make sure you understand what I'm doing, hit enter, and then you can see that the values for the derivative change, positive and then negative. And here, again, you can see that I've just taken, and I need to multiply each of these by 1,000. And you can see what happens there to my revenue and how my revenue is changing. So again, first times derivative of second plus the second times the derivative of the first. Enter that and drag it down. These values are how the revenue is changing. So we would say at a price of 76 cents, the revenue is increasing at a rate of $487,950.30. Sorry, I said that crazy. $487,950.30 for every dollar increase in price at that specific level. When we look at how it's changing at $3.50, we would say, well, it's still increasing, but it's certainly not increasing as fast. And then you can see at $50, it's certainly not increasing anywhere near as fast as it was at the top. And then we might want to go back over here and describe what happens at a price of 70. So at a price of $70 per widget, wow, the revenue is decreasing. The revenue is decreasing at a rate of $19,576.79 per every dollar increase in price. Okay, feel free to stop, review that. I'm going to go on to this next piece where I talk about maximum revenue. Now that we have our spreadsheet all set up, we basically want to talk about what happens, or how can you find maximum revenue. So you've heard me several times already say we can achieve maximum revenue when our derivative is 0. So basically, we're going to go into our derivative function, and in our derivative function, we're going to goal seek our derivative to 0. The cell that I'm changing here, remember, is my independent variable always, goal seek, to 0. The price has to change. Okay, so what this is saying is that at a price of, looks like about $62.50, my revenue would actually be $11,496,232.54. The derivative is 0, and this, interestingly enough, should be 0. Revenue is stable, it's at its maximum, nothing's happening there. So we've answered this question, find the price for a widget that maximizes the revenue, and then what is the max revenue? We answered both of those simply by identifying through goal seek this price and this revenue. And then why does the maximum or minimum occur when the derivative is equal to 0? Well, hopefully all of you remember that what's going on there is simply that we have a function where we've hit the top value. Perhaps it's a quadratic function. In this one, it's not quadratic, but we could graph that and see what it is. But it's because the graph of our tangent line has a slope of 0.